5. I am a full-time agent. I am a single mom with two kids. I have a son that is 18 and a daughter that's 21, and both of them are in ridiculously expensive colleges. I've been consistently farming for the last 6 years, and I am a resident in my farm in Northlake and Passaic. It's made up of three tracts: the Wildwoods, the Ridgewoods, and the Cedar Points. In 2017, and these are my numbers for my total business, not just my farm, 86% sellers, 14% buyers, and as Frank mentioned, 19.7% market share in my farm. 33% of my business last year came from my farm, 46% came from past clients, and 21% came from expired listings. I have sold 44 homes in my farm total. Actually, that's not including one I just closed.
Yeah.
Anyway, I door knock once a week, and I average about 30 to 34 doors an hour. It depends on the conversation with people. Sometimes it takes less time if nobody's home or we're in a deep conversation. I send out something in the mail once a month, and I host two events a year. We're going to go over all of this. And I post once a week on the Northlake Facebook group page. So we're going to get into details about all that. So what is real estate farming? It's geographic farming involves targeting your marketing efforts to a specific area or neighborhood consistently. So I want to talk about this word, consistently. I've been, again, up to a lot of classes, a lot of seminars, and sometimes you're like so pumped and motivated and you're like, dang, that was like the best thing I went to. I'm going to implement this, I'm going to implement that. And then 2-3 weeks later, you completely forget about what you learned. So if you get anything out of this class, I don't care if you have a crappy flyer, I don't care if you don't know what to say when you door knock, if you do this, you'll get business.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
No matter what. So if you forget everything I teach you today, just remember that. Okay, so picking a farm. I had somebody, they might be in the audience, called me and said that they invested all this money into their farm. They sent out postcards, they door knocked, they did all this stuff, spent a ton of money, and they didn't get anything from it. And I asked them, did you do any research to pick your farm? They said, no, I just wanted to do it here. So there is actually a science to picking a farm. There really is. And who's going to come up here right now, Nora Hall, to talk about this.
So you guys really did all show up. My name is Nora Hall. I'm with Fidelity National Title Company, and I'm so glad to be here today. Thank you so much to Frank and to Tracy. I am really, really passionate about farming, but first I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself. I've been in title since 2005. I started when I was 12 years old, and I've been with my current company for 2 years. So exactly what that says. My big why is building relationships and helping you build your business. And that's kind of cliche to hear that at this point, right? I'm not sure if you've noticed, but there's like 75 title reps in this valley all vying for your business. So the way that I really set myself apart and the way that I help you grow is through helping you in your farms. So it came up for my partner Yvonne and I. She's back there. We would sit with agents, and we would sit across from them, and they'd be really excited about farming. And we'd print them their door knocking book. Who here has a door knocking book with them, right, that they've got from their title rep? And then 2 weeks later, we'd go to the same office and see that agent, and there it is sitting on their desk, still in the package that it was delivered in, right? And we're like, okay. And then the next week, it's still there, and it becomes a dusty paperweight, and eventually goes into the trash. And we discovered that the reason for that was because they were not equipped to go out into their farm. They weren't confident in what they were going to say at the door, what they were going to give to them, or anything like that. So we developed a system to help them in their farm areas. So I will be here after the class. I'm going to be here for the duration and then after. I'd love to grab a business card and set a time to meet with you, one-on-one or in a small group, because that's really where we're going to talk about the factors that Tracy's going to put up in a second that will help you determine the farm area in which you will have the most likelihood for success. Okay, good. She's like, why is she looking at me? Okay, so really there's five factors, and it's not one of these is going going to determine your success, but location is important. So proximity to where you live or where you work. Please don't tell me that you live in Valencia and work in Castaic and tell me you're going to farm in Burbank. That's not going to work, right? Proximity and also count go hand in hand. First of all, if you're not familiar with the area that you're considering farming, like Tracy lives in her farm, which is awesome. That's not to say that you have to farm where you live. But if you're not familiar with the area, get in your car and drive around. Because I can't tell you how many times I've met with an agent, we get a great area, good turnover rate, my sister lives there, it's gonna be great. She goes door knocking, she's like, oh my gosh, these people are weird that live here. So she wasted like 2 months, right? And whatever material she printed for them, all of that. So drive around your area to get to know it. Don't pick an area that's gated, first of all, that's tough. This is not so much for the Santa Clarita Valley, but in the San Fernando Valley, for example, there's areas where individual homes have gates. That's also not gonna work for you to door knock. So get to know the area before you commit to it. Count. So I love when people are excited, because I'm excited, right? But don't tell me you want a farm with 1,500 records in it. Please just don't. Because it's, unless you're an experienced agent and you're an experienced door knocker, you've got a system down, you're gonna get crazy overwhelmed. That's just the fact of the matter. I say start with no more, whether you're experienced or not, if you're starting in a brand new farm, no more than 500, okay? That's just to maximize your success. We can always add. But let's start with about 500. I love what Tracy said. So retired people have lots of time. And when you knock on their door, they're going to talk to you for like 30 minutes, probably, right? Maybe they sell essential oils, and then they're going to explain their whole business plan to you. You never know. So just a little math equation. So 500 homes to reach that in a month, 4 weeks. You go out twice a week, you have to door knock 2 hours, and that's hitting 32-ish doors a day. If you lose a half hour, you're going to have to make that time up. Do you see what I'm saying? So you have to be honest with yourself about the time that you have to dedicate and the money. So you're not going to get a listing because you have the glossiest postcard on the block. That's not going to happen. But you are going to print material, of course. You have to present yourself as the local real estate expert. That'll cost money if you're going to mail on your farm, right? Mm-hmm. Tracy's farm is 279
records. Yep.
So she chose a farm that was manageable for her because she mails to them every month. Postage is not cheap. She buys special envelopes for her farm, and she prints stuff for her farm. That's all money, right, that you're investing. Doing that for 279 versus 1500 is totally different, right? Okay, and then the actual area itself. 90% occupancy, that's ideal. Owner occupancy is what that should say. When we're knocking in our farms, who do we want to talk to? Our homeowners. Yes, Shane.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
So, Tracy?
Yes.
How much money do you think on average that you spend in your farm on the 279 homes? Well, like how much do you normally on average spend on a monthly basis?
If somebody has a calculator, it's 47 cents every time I send out a letter a month. I buy envelopes in bulk. And I want to say I get like $1,000 for $50. I should have put that link up there. So that's several months of mailing stuff. And I get my printing done at a discount. I have somebody that helps me out with that because I go to them every month to print stuff. So that's really my only expense because I door knock with the same flyer that I mail. So I print extras so I can go door knock. And then out of every paycheck, I set money aside for events. And the Facebook group is free. Yes.
So I want to point out what that question there is really important because the one thing that I know, because I meet with the top 20% of my office, and one of the things that I always market them about and that she's really good at is she knows her numbers. Yeah. She knows her numbers on what she's doing on a monthly basis. And that is a major, major contribution to her success.
Okay, that's new. That wasn't always.
Okay, you're good?
Oh, you're welcome.
All right, so we're back to the area. So now we're talking about your actual farm, the geographical area, right? So we want to make sure that most of the people, ideally 90% of the people that you're going to knock on their door, we want the person answering to be the homeowner, not a tenant. Of course, we still talk to tenants. We love them. We want them to be homeowners, right? And we're going to find them a home. But we want it to be at least 90% owner-occupied. Turnover rate. So there's no magic number, guys. There's so many factors involved in that. And when we sit one-on-one, we'll discuss that a little bit more. But we absolutely analyze that and factor that into selecting a farm, for sure. Median sales price.
Can I say something about that?
Please.
The turnover rate is really important because there's a lot of neighborhoods like out in Newhall, Valencia, where people are going to live there and die in that house. So you need to know those numbers, because if you're going to spend all this money in neighborhoods where people just want to grow old and give that house to their kids, you're wasting your time.
So
it's really important to know that.
That's true. So there's areas, Santa Clarita, typically the Santa Clarita Valley will have a better turnover rate than the San Fernando Valley. Not to say that there aren't pockets in the San Fernando Valley, but say, for example, in the city of Granada Hills, excuse me, I'm excited to see a 5. Like, that's great, right? Because people, I mean, it's all full of empty nesters. So these are all factors together to take into consideration, okay? Whereas, you know, condo complex in Saugus, that baby's going to turn and burn, right? So that's what we look at. Median sales price. That also factors into turnover a little bit, too. Not only is it your paycheck, that's important, right? You want to see how much homes are selling for. If you're going to invest your time, let's make sure that it equates with the goal that you have. But if we're dealing with homes that are over $1 million, they just don't turn over as often than a condo for $450. See what I'm saying? So it's not one of these, it's kind of all of these in conjunction with one another that will determine success in a farm. Agent domination. So if you tell me, I don't care, I'm the baddest on the block, I'm gonna take over my farm area, I say, heck yeah, you are. But let's know who your competition is, right? Or you're gonna say, I'm thinking about farming north, like I'm gonna be like, this lady Tracy has like 20% market share. Let's find another area. So does everyone feel me on this? Are we good? Any questions? No? Okay, cool. Sorry. No, sorry. All right, so my tools. So this is where I really, really, really bring value to you guys. Because again, I'm not going to throw a book at you. I'm not going to have you download an app and tell you to give me a call when you've got your first title order. Walking farm books are great. Tracy has them. She uses them, right?
I do.
I'll get them for you. But that's just the tiniest portion of the equation. A walking farm book, in case anyone is curious about that, is a booklet with all of the properties located within your farm area sorted by assessor parcel number. And the reason we sort by parcel number versus address is because, of course, addresses are odd even and parcel numbers are numerical. It's just easier to walk down one side of the street and not have to pop all over the place, right? Door knocking app. Ours is the best. It's really easy to use. It's fantastic. And I'll train you to use it. Because 90% of the time, if somebody sets an app up on their phone and you don't train them to use it, I actually will save your farm in your app for you. You're never going to use it. But what it does do, where the app is a little more integrated, sort of with CRMs and things like that, it allows you to, it just is really easy to follow up with whatever leads you get when you're out door knocking. It'll take notes, it'll automatically timestamp the time and day that you were there. So that's a very cool feature. And then additional marketing tools. So I have access to 100% free of branded marketing for you guys. I don't care if you're closing 100 transactions a year or 1.5. Everybody likes free stuff. I like free stuff. So I'll get you set up with programs that will allow you to create things like, if you're brand new in a farm area, you need to introduce yourself. Right? Not necessarily as a new agent. Actually, don't introduce yourself as a brand new agent, please. But you'll introduce yourself to the area as the local real estate professional, right? So I have templates for that, fantastic templates for open houses, If you're doing your own open house or an open house for another agent, I can create templates for that as well. I'm just making sure I'm not forgetting something. And then the next that is my website, whereas, you know, everyone's got their website on their business card. Well, mine is actually a treasure chest of free marketing for you guys. And you're like, what? Title can't provide marketing. So we have real estate information flyers on our website. And yes, they have the little Fidelity logo at the top, but it's really great information. Because again, you can definitely door knock a recipe for strudel. That's totally fine. But that doesn't set you apart as an expert. And so everything you'll find on my website, for example, information about Melrose, information about living trusts, probate information, property tax prorations, things like that. Even if you put it on the back of whatever market update you're doing, it really just solidifies you as an expert. And again, this is all free. Email addresses and phone numbers. So there are outside vendors that will provide you that data for a geographical area. So how powerful is it that you can obtain email addresses and phone numbers and knock with, so let's say this month we are doing a market update and information about Melrose. So you're gonna knock with that, you're gonna hit all your homes, you're gonna do an email blast on your farm, and you're gonna send a text message to all of the available cell phone numbers within your farm area. I mean, it doesn't get much better than that. We're so fortunate to be able to have that option. And then I think your greatest tool is having me as your ally, because I will make a marketing plan with you. So again, I'm not gonna print a book, I'm not going to send you an email with, you know, here's the app that you should download, let me know how it goes. I will really make a plan, sit down with you, find out what your goal is. My goal is to work to be a partner in your business. And so that's what I will do. And again, I will be here after the class. Did I cover everything?
Yes, sir.
Did I?
Thank you, guys.
Any questions? All right. Thank you very much.
Expireds, but when an expired listing comes up, I door knock them ASAP. There aren't that many in my neighborhood, but when they do, I definitely go after those. Because they're basically people with their hand up in the air saying, I wanted to sell, and my last agent couldn't get it sold for whatever reason. You also need to know your different tracks and the floor plans and the square footage. The best and quickest way to do that is to go into every house that's on the market. You can also look in the MLS and basically just try to determine how many of them have this square footage, how many of them have that square footage. You can pretty much figure it out. Yes?
So you say you door knock an expiry in your farm. How have you gotten any results from that? How's that work?
Oh, that's okay. It has worked, but not face-to-face. It's actually worked with sending a letter. I also door knock, but I have never gotten an expired listing in my farm from face-to-face, only from a letter. And I just hammer them until they tell me to stop.
So what, two letters?
No.
Three letters?
No.
No?
No.
How many letters per week? Do you have a strategy, a 10-week
once
strategy? Once a week?
Uh-huh.
To the list or go somewhere else?
One of the greatest things I learned was from Miss Mendoza over there. Yes, you. Is when we used to talk about prospecting, don't assume that you're bugging them. That's in your own head, right? Unless they tell you, you just keep going, okay? So let's talk about HOA. If your farm has an HOA, that's awesome. Go to all the HOA meetings if non-residences are allowed. Meet the HOA president. The reason you want to do this is because they're probably going to be threatened by the Facebook group page that you're going to put together.
I have in here something that you're going to post on your Facebook group that basically says, I have nothing to do with the HOA. If you have a problem with the HOA, talk to the HOA. Because they don't like losing control of their residents. So you want to become friends with them. It's also a good idea to go to these HOA meetings because you're going to learn about upcoming events, projects, any concerns in the neighborhood. I know sometimes there's people that don't want to door knock talking about real estate business, so going to these things and knowing like the upcoming Easter egg hunt, it's something that you can talk that's easy to talk about. And you also need to know about the surrounding areas. Google is going to be your best friend. You need to know the surrounding areas. Google about the school, the ratings of the schools, and any new restaurants, parks, activities you guys can.
Tracy?
Yes.
When you met with the HOA president, what was your conversation like and how did you frame it?
Actually, at the time, when I did the, when we built the Facebook group, one of the things I'm going to tell you is you don't want to be the only admin. You want to do it with a couple other residences. It looks kind of strange if the realtor in the neighborhood is the admin. It kind of doesn't go over very well. So you want to do it with other people. At the time when I set it up, the lady Michelle, she was actually on the board, and so when we discussed it, putting it together, it was a really easy conversation. But honestly, I don't. If you come from a place of I want to help the residences, I want to bring people together, it's kind of like the next door, but for personal, for our neighborhood, they get it. They understand. We actually work really well together, the HOA and our Facebook page. So let's talk about prospecting, because I know you all did your 3 hours of prospecting this morning before you came to class. Okay, mindset. Let's talk about mindset. Some of you know here that I come from an acting background, and there was a time in my career that I could not get a job. I could not get a job to save my life. I didn't know what it was, and I was desperate. And I would go on auditions, and the feedback from casting directors to my agent was, is she comes off like desperate, like she needs the work. It's important when you door knock, just like when you go on listing appointments, that they don't sense that from you. When I go door knocking and I don't have any business, and that happens sometimes, I have to check within myself and go, why am I going door knocking? The mindset needs to be, it's not about selling, it's not about sales, it's not about you. It's about helping people and building relationships. One of the things that I always say to myself when I go door knocking is I'm just going to go today, meet people, and put as many people in my database as possible. That's it. That's my focus. That's all that matters. Because if I keep doing that on a daily basis, the business is going to come. Oh, I wanted to say one more thing. When I first started door knocking, I got my first job, my first listing was from door knocking. In fact, the last person that sold the house was Lord Tom. So I got my first listing in Northlake, and it took me 6 months to get my first job. And all I did was door knock. And for the first several months, all I door knocked was this postcard, and it was a recipe from my Grandma Robin for apple pie. And I just kept door knocking with this recipe because I thought that's what we do. That's like, I didn't know what I was supposed to do, and I didn't get any business from it. And at the time, my coach said, why are you doing this? This isn't showing you as an expert. You're not giving them any item of value. So I quickly had to change that and turned it into what people really want to know is what their home is worth, what things are selling for. I know you guys all know this, but it's very easy sometimes when you're scared to door knock to just take the Lakers basketball schedule with you or to take the baseball schedule or the closest pumpkin patches. You can do that, but bring information about the specific neighborhood. That's what matters, and that's what sets you as the expert. Okay, so let's talk about door knocking. The quickest way to build relationships is through face recognition. So I door knock once a week. It's gotten to the point where I door knock so much when I door knock, people answer the door, they know who I am. You want to get to that place where it's like second nature, it's not scary. When I've gone a couple weeks without door knocking for whatever reason, I still get nervous about doing it, but it's like getting on a bike. You just got to get back into it again. The handouts that I give, we're gonna go over in a few minutes. I'm gonna come back to that. But let's talk about door dropping. Our team leader and I do not agree on this concept. I do not believe in just door droppings. I believe you need to talk to people. You need to build relationships with people. Yep, I think it's a waste of money. And a lot of times what happens when I go door knocking is I see people's stuff, like the gardener or the termite companies or whatever, all their stuff is on the ground, and people, residents, they go through their garage, they go in their house, they don't see it for days. I'm ignoring the man in the bathroom. But I just think it's a waste. Now, maybe at one time it was okay to door drop, kind of like when people did postcards with an 800 number and people were kind of naive. It's like, oh, let me call this 800 number, and they didn't realize their phone number was going to get captured. I just don't believe in door dropping. Yes.
So my only, don't just door drop. I think that everything that she's telling you is on point. It's amazing. But I do door dropping to add additional exposure, because when you door knock and they don't answer and you have something, what do you do with it? Door drop. So I believe that it's an amazing technique in addition to doing all of this other stuff. Don't just door drop. I know people that have just door dropped and they're out of business. So don't just do that.
Carlos, I think your hand is up.
You mentioned you door knock once a week. Do you door knock every property once a week, or you break it down to?
I break it down. I know exactly where I'm starting. I break it up into sections. So I know exactly, so I know where to start again the next week.
So every property you door knock maybe once a month?
Yes. It doesn't take me long to get through it because it's only 279 homes. That's what I like, it's manageable. Yes.
Okay, so if you don't door drop, then if no one's home, do not leave something.
I do. I leave something if they're not home. And I always write on there, sorry I missed you.
Mostly.
It's not the same thing as
working.
Yes. Yes.
How many hours?
I try to do a minimum of two.
Awesome.
Yeah. If you just do one, it's going to take you forever. And it goes by really fast. And it's actually really fun talking to people. And I do not door knock houses that say no solicitation.
Yeah.
Observe that. I don't do that either. Yes, was that your question?
No. What time of day is best?
You know what? I just find any time of day is good within reason. I mean, I'm not going to door knock at 9 a.m. on a Saturday. But, you know, I'd like to try to go when most people are home. I know my neighborhood is made up of a lot of families with smaller kids. So I know between like 8:30 and 9:30, they might be dropping off kids. They're probably not going to be home. They're going to be busy, so I try to wait till like 10 or 11. But it's better to go in my neighborhood as well on the weekends. A lot of people are on the weekends. Let's see, any other questions? Yes.
Do you keep notes on when you talk to people, like things they tell you?
Great question. I go door knock, I have a stack of whatever I'm handing out, and on the very back page, the last page, I flip it over. So if I'm doing all of Mariposa and I talk to 27748 Mariposa, I'll just put 27748, dog Binky, mom is sick. I'll make myself little notes of the conversation that we had, because I always send a handwritten note afterwards, and I try to mention the things that we discussed. Yes.
So if you had Nora's app, couldn't you be able to do that in Nora's app? Just saying.
So yes, Nora's app. That's what it's called.
So
the booklet always has an area for you to make notations or on a piece of paper. I mean, that works as well. But the app actually will date and timestamp when you're there, and you can dictate to it. I wouldn't do that standing in front of the homeowner, but they're going to kind of vomit all this information onto you, and you're going to say, okay, I'll get back to you on that, and you're excited and you're nervous, and they shut the door, and you're like, I don't remember what they said. So then you can dictate whatever they said, like dog Binky. Of course, you can also type it in, like if they give you their phone number or email address, of course, you can type that in as well. And then it saves everything. And then you said something about time of day to door knock. Mm-hmm. So that's why the app is so great. And you can write it down too. But if it's your fourth time at the same door, and you're like, oh, I kind of have been here around the same time, for 4 days, four trips in a row, and I haven't gotten anyone at home, you can make a little note to yourself. Try in the afternoon. See what I'm saying? So it helps keep track of it that way. Thank you.
That's very cool. One of the things I talked about in one of my videos was speed dating for door knocking. I don't know if people saw that video that I did. But one of the things I try to do is I try to build rapport as quickly as possible. So let's say, for example, this is just an example, they answer the door and they have a teenage daughter standing in the background and a middle school age daughter. And I'll make a point to say, oh, did they go to Castaic Middle School? Oh yeah, my kids went to Castaic Middle School. Oh wow, so did my kids. Did they go to Northrop Elementary too? Yeah, they did. I said, oh, that's so funny. Do you know Mrs. Cook? That's my kid's grandma. She taught fourth grade. And I just try to find any little way to get my foot in the door to have a conversation about anything but real estate. Because obviously our job is for them to know, like, and trust us. So I try to do that. They have a dog. Oh, what a cute dog. I have a dog. I have a beagle. He eats everything. You know, I just try to, like, have a conversation so they'll start a conversation with me. So I just wanted to make sure I mentioned that. People respect the hustle. I got a listing because I door knocked in the rain. If it's raining, that is the best day to go door knocking. The best. They love that. They'll remember you. It's awesome. Awesome. And when you get discouraged, the next door could actually be your next opportunity. It's just like calling expired. Right, John? A lady named Hillary Broadwater. Email me and I'll give you her information. She's awesome.
Her runner's
really
cute, too.
What's that?
Her runner. So let's talk about scripts and then we'll talk about the handouts. In your packet are three scripts that I gave you. The first script, the opening, is what I usually say. On the bottom two, I left it kind of more generic so you guys can make it your own. One of the things that Frank and I talk about, we talk about scripts a lot, is you need to internalize the script, but you need to make it your own. I am not one that follows the script to a T, but I know my way in and out of this script, and I know my objections in and out of the objection handler. So you want to put your own personality into it. I mean, you guys see on my videos, I make an ass of myself because I just like showing people that I'm willing to laugh at myself. I'm willing to laugh with you. I like doing funny videos because that's who I am. But you got to make it your own, and that's super, super important. You walk up to a door and you're like literally like reading it like no personality, you sound like a salesperson. So try really hard just to be yourself. I like my conversations at doors to be conversational, not so much a script. So you guys, those are for you to keep. Open houses. It's important to know that it does not need to be your listing, especially if you're just starting out. Ask someone to do their open house. I've talked about mega open houses before where I door knock the entire neighborhood and I invite everybody to. What ended up happening is a lot of people in the neighborhood had their own businesses, their own, like, one was selling lip scents, one was making jewelry, and the other person was doing Camping Chef. So we did a holiday boutique. And everybody came together, we did a holiday boutique, they made a ton of money, we all drank wine, we got drunk, it was fun. Okay. When I do a mailer every month, I send it in the same color envelope. No matter what. Same color envelope. For years. It's a light blue envelope, and what's interesting is I started doing that when I was working on a team. When I came off of the team, I got my own branding, a new picture. Nothing was light blue, but I didn't want to change it because when people get the mail, they see the light blue envelope, and I'm hoping, I'm pretty sure they know it's for me. Yes?
So should somebody pick a color, or is white okay? What do you think?
I think you should do a color that stands out. That's just my opinion. You can do what you want. But yeah, I always do a color so it's recognizable. And then the other thing I did this flyer, this soul map. Now, if you haven't done a lot of business in your farm, but you've done business in the area, this could be that you sell Santa Clarita. And it could be all the sales you've done in Santa Clarita. I did that for the longest time because I didn't have enough to put in just my farm. I want to point out on every flyer that I send, it's usually the same verbiage. I ask people to check out my reviews on that website. And I always, always, always put the same verbiage. Please join our North Lake Facebook group for updates in our neighborhood. Search North Lake Neighbors in Facebook to join. There's 279 homes. We have 296 members. So, and new people come into the neighborhood all the time. So it's always good to just keep that in there. I want to talk about a couple more handouts that I did that I don't have up here. One thing that I did was for Halloween and maybe Easter, I did a coloring contest. You just Google forget what you Google, but like Easter pictures to color or something like that. You print them up, you put your information on the bottom, and I did a coloring contest for the kids. Of course, every kid got a gift card because I love kids and there are no losers, but it's so much fun. And what I did was is I would let the homeowners know, oh my gosh, your son Billy won, and I was wondering if I could come by and bring you his, you know, bring you his gift card. And then I show up, they're excited, I give it to them, take a picture, post it on the Facebook group page, and it just kind of takes off like wildfire. Kids love that. I love kids. I posted a video today, it came up in my memories. One day I was out door knocking, and Andre and Jonathan, they live across the street from me, the cutest little boys. They're like, what are you doing? I'm like, oh, I'm going door knocking. Can we go with you? Yeah, come with me.
Oh,
so they followed me house to house and we went door knocking. I mean, there is no right or wrong way. But that's me. I love kids. Hang out with me. Let's go together. It'll be fun. If you go past the scripts, I also sent out this article one year. I think this is from 2016. Zillow and the Realtor. I wrote this because I was sick of people telling me what their Zestimate was. So I was like, I'm just going to deal with this in one letter and mail it out all at the same time. This is a great letter, and I actually included stories, something that actually happened within Northlake, so it's kind of like a subliminal message. I know what I'm talking about in Northlake. I work Northlake. This happened in your neighborhood. So it's current and it's present. And I sent this, I think I did this once because I didn't have any listings to send. So sometimes you gotta think outside of the box. This is still real estate related, but I didn't have any listings or closed sales recent enough to send. So that's for you guys to keep. I know what else I wanted to say. When I first started in door knocking, there was an agent, Tom Easy. Does anyone know who Tom Easy is? I think that guy's awesome. I think he's awesome. When I first started door knocking, I was like, oh my God, why are you being pretty? You just be this, you just be that, you just be gorgeous. This is what Tom Acey would door knock with. It's an MLS sheet.
Yeah. Is that
literally an MLS sheet. Huh?
Is that actually it?
No. It's an MLS sheet, and under actives and sold, he says A, active, S, sold. This is sold price, this is price per square foot, and then he had his business card. And that guy was so charismatic, and he would just talk to people, and he would get listings, and he didn't just farm Norfolk, he farmed a lot of places. But it just kind of made me take note that if your flyer does not need to be perfect. If you're going to try to make it perfect, you're never going to get out there. It's just giving the information and building relationships with people. So hats off to Tom if he's watching. One last thing I want to show you is this is my OA folder, other agents. Every time I get something in the mail of other agents, I keep it. This is years. This is like gold. This is like a treasure. Because I'll go in when I'm like, I don't know what to say, I don't know what to do. I'll look in here and I'll get inspired. And sometimes I don't use what they have, but it makes me think of another way to say it. So don't throw that stuff away. It's good stuff. This is a typical flyer that I don't know quite. In escrow, sold in 2 days, and then I put the just solds. So I separated out. Most people know what track they live in. I always put the square footage. Yes?
Is this whole presentation going to, like, the slides are you going to have?
I'm going to email it to everybody. I'm emailing the whole PowerPoint, and I'm also emailing this if you use it.
That's awesome.
It's $50 a person. And then again, I always put the same thing, the same call to action, telling them to go to my reviews. Don't go there. There's one bad review, but I replied to her. She won't back. The Facebook. So it's always good to just keep repeating that.
Tracy?
Yes.
Just a quick question. Also, but when you put just solds or here's all these listings, do you have to reference who the agents were that?
Not when it's sold. And I don't have a flyer up here, but if it's something that I sold, I put sold by Tracy.
Yeah.
But if it's sold, you don't have to worry about that. I can't put actives and pending.
I didn't know if that had
not
changed to where credit has to be due to the people, because it could look like these were all
not
yours.
Not that I'm aware of.
There's a line at the bottom of your flyer that just kind of keep you within BRD regulations that you have to put. And everybody here can call a broker Debbie Penny all at one time and ask
her. It's right here. If your home is currently listed, please disregard. It's not our intention to solicit.
Well, I just went to an association meeting, that's why I'm asking that.
Yeah.
That came as a surprise to the people. Just there, I think there may be a new rule, just to be aware and everybody check it out.
Okay. Very good, thank you. Yes.
If there's already a Facebook group in that community, do you recommend starting the second one?
I would try to join that group and see how effective it is and if there's a lot of people actually participating. I'm going to pull up my Northland Facebook group page. I mean, daily there's multiple posts. So that's what I would do. I mean, I honestly, it's just like my philosophy in real estate, there's enough business for everybody. So that one Facebook group page isn't doing much, make another. Why not call something different?
Or just add to it.
Well, if you're not the admin on it, that would be hard to do. I don't know if you said that.
I did.
Oh.
But I mean, like, you can post in it.
Yeah, you can post in it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, but the thing I like about my Facebook group, and I'm going to show you, is I have total control. When new people go on there and sign up to that group, I literally can go into members and start sending them Facebook friend requests.
Tracy, do you have any realtors in your neighborhood?
Yes, great question. I'm getting to that. When I first started, there were 5 agents in my neighborhood, all of them extremely successful, but the only one that door knocked regularly in my neighborhood was Tommy's, and he didn't just do Northlake. So there is an agent in our office. I love him. He's awesome. We share an office wall. And again, I believe there's enough business for everybody. I don't flaunt anything in his face. When I send out mailers, I try to look through and don't send it to people that they don't, you know what I mean? They're not going to benefit from receiving that. Save my 47 cents. So, but yeah, don't let that intimidate you. You really shouldn't. Let's see here. Okay, so this is another flyer. I had a listing. So again, you guys get the idea. So let's talk about the private Facebook group page. Let me go through this and then I'll bring it up on the computer. So create it and they will come. One of the things I was door knocking, and I always put stuff in there about new listings, escrows, and also houses that I've closed in Northlake. And then one day I was door knocking and the homeowner said to me, oh my God, my mom, she just listed her house in Granada Hills and she moved to Valencia, and my mouth was like on the floor. I was like, really? Oh my gosh, I didn't know you guys needed an agent to do that. She's like, well, yeah, I would abuse you, but you only sell in Northlake. And it dawned on me that I was doing an awesome job pushing Northlake, but I wasn't putting in there other places that I sell. So now when I take other listings or something's pending, I put it in there. So for example, I'll tell you how I frame it, is if I had a condo listing in Oxnard, I might post things about the condo and say, hey, looking for a vacation home near the ocean? I just listed this and I put all the information. So it's really important not to lose sight of that, because I want them to know I'm busy, but I'm not too busy, and I sell all these different areas. The other thing about the private Facebook group is it's a great place to post all your events and save money. Just like our office Facebook group, don't assume that they only look at Facebook. Not everybody's on Facebook, so you can't just do that. Just want to mention that. Okay, so let me pull it up and show you. So if you guys turn to the Facebook group stuff in your packet, from this brokerage, from other brokerages, are trying to become a member in the Facebook group page. This is why you want to be one of the admins. Again, I strongly suggest don't be the only admin. Ask a neighbor to do it with you, or ask somebody on the board to do it with you that lives in the neighborhood. Thank you. So you can see right here we have 296 members. Michelle is one of the admins. So just to show you some of the posts, it's a book sale. This neighbor put out a bunch of Meyer lemons, and everybody was, she was offering them to people. Somebody made a bun cake with the lemons. I mean, just, this is the kind of stuff that people post. Missing cat. They literally lost like three cats in the same day.
Oh, no.
Conspiracy. So just to give you an idea. One more thing I want to show you guys, this is the quickest way to build your database, is if you go into all your members, see like Alita, all I got to do is go on her thing and see that we're already friends, see we're already friends, but what I do once a week is to see who joined. But there's going to be people here where I'll go over their name. But basically, you go through and you find people, and it'll say, instead of friends, it'll say send friend request. And that's how I build my database. Because not only do I want to be friends with them, through our Facebook group page, but I want them to see the stuff that I do on my personal Facebook page as well. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Under your personal Facebook page, do you then put them into that group of your community or your farm?
Uh-uh.
Right? Do you label them as?
You know, I don't group in my personal Facebook. I don't group. What I've learned to do is when I boost things or I do things, how to do it without realtors and with realtors. So I'm simple. I don't separate them all. Let's see. Does anyone have any questions about the Facebook group page?
Tracy.
Oh,
real quick, I must have missed it. You do accept other real estate agents into your
group?
No. No? Okay.
No.
Okay.
So if you're the admin of the group, I mean, like, I don't want to name names.
Very
thoughtful. Did we get it?
Yeah.
Well, no, Greg is part of it because he lives in the neighborhood. But Greg and I live on the same street. But there's other agents in this office and other offices that send a request, and you can either accept them, deny them, or block them. I just block them. They don't need to be there. They don't have any business being there. Yes. So if you go to your very last page of your packet, thank you. We're going to talk about that. I actually give you the verbiage. So when people start saying, Bobby Smith, you get a Facebook member request. That's what it'll say, member request, Bobby Smith. And you're like, I don't see Bobby Smith on the list that I got from the HOA or the list from Title. So you're going to send Bobby a message. And this top part is the message. Dear Bobby, I'm one of the admins for the Northwood Neighbors Facebook page. You requested to join. And it's a very nice message. You're basically trying to find out if they live in the neighborhood. Maybe they just rent and they don't live in the neighborhood. You want to figure that out. If they don't respond, we usually send these messages out 3 times. If they don't respond, they're not joining.
How long did you set it up where you can ask them questions when you know some clues?
Yes, you can set it up, and that's in here, where you can actually set it up. But this is just the verbiage, because I believe you can write your own verbiage, so I just wanted to give it to you guys. You guys obviously will make it your own. The other thing I mentioned is remember when I said if there's an HOA in your farm and you want to do a Facebook page and you want to tell them, listen, this is not about bashing the HOA because everybody has complaints about the HOA. This is a pinned post, and this is what's actually in our Facebook group. This is the pinned post. It talks about you know, if you have an issue with HOA, talk to these people. This isn't about bashing your neighbors. It's not anything negative. We basically, it's the framework of what's allowed and not allowed. Yes?
Do you put any of that on your flyers as far as being part of the Facebook group or how to be a part of the Facebook group if somebody's not? How do you get people to initially jump into the Facebook group?
It's a conversation I have at every door that I knock, and it's on every flyer that I send out, and on every letter, that it's everywhere.
One last question. You put the renters in the Facebook group as well, and the out-of-area owners that own within the farm as well?
Out-of-owners, yes, renters, yes.
You don't put the renters on the Facebook page?
Why not?
Huh?
Why not?
Because eventually they're going to move, and they're no longer going to be the home. I mean, they're no longer going to be living there.
What if you sell them the house they live in?
Then they're a homeowner. That's just our rule, to kind of keep the, I don't want to say riffraff, but to kind of maintain control.
Did you come up with that with the HOA? Did you guys work that out together?
The HOA has nothing to do with our Facebook group, except we got the, hey, we're going to do this, and don't give us any problem because this is what we're trying to do. We're not trying to make it a forum for people to complain about the HOA. So we set up our own guidelines, myself and the two other administrators on the group page, and how we wanted to conduct it. And I mean, it grew like wildfire. It really did. It was really simple. You'll be surprised how easy it is as long as you consistently keep telling people about the Facebook group page. Yes?
How much time do you put into maintaining this page on a daily or weekly basis?
I post once a week. I try to go in there every day and see what people are posting and have conversations with people in the neighborhood. I try not to just like it. If somebody lost their cat, I keep my eye out. I try to help them, of course, anything. One thing that I did, maybe you guys saw it, was these two sweet, sweet little girls, again, Canadian kids, sweet little girls. They're door knocking the neighborhood with their red wagon and their mom selling Girl Scout cookies. And they're absolutely adorable, and of course I had to buy some Girl Scout cookies, and they said that their goal, I actually asked them, I said, do you guys have a goal? They said, yes, we want to sell 1,000 boxes of Girl Scout cookies. I was like, 1,000 boxes? They're like, yeah, that's our goal. And they had like a chart, they were charting it. I mean, like, all of us could do better at all of that stuff, and these kids were just killing it. And so I asked the mom if they reached their goal, would it be okay if I did a little video with them? Because I'm just so impressed that they had goals and were trying to reach them, they were tracking their goals, etc. So we did a little video, and I posted it on the Northlake Facebook group, and then I tagged the mom, and it was on her Facebook group. It's like over 600 views. People all over Castaic are commenting on it. Oh my God, my daughter's in Girl Scouts. And now the mom's trying to start a new troop. So it's just kind of like, you gotta think outside the box. So it made me think, if all these people are into watching this, maybe there's other people in my neighborhood that wanna be featured. Maybe they're starting a new business or what have you. I know there's a lot of agents now that'll go through Santa Clarita Valley and they'll interview the new ice cream store, or things like that. This is like on a smaller scale, but in my farm. Yes.
What equipment do you use for doing your video?
That phone right there.
High tech.
That's pretty high tech.
Yeah.
But like for audio, you don't use a special mic.
I just recently bought a microphone. I'll include that in my email. It's $12 on Amazon. It's a lavalier mic. $12. That plugs into my phone. Yes.
Real quick, on the Facebook post that you do on the page, do you get a lot of response from the people that are members? Like, does everybody hit like on your stuff or share or comment?
It depends. Not all the time. Sometimes I'll get two or three likes. Sometimes I'll get so many. It depends on what it is.
Right.
Recently, I sold a house with Sandy Holkey. Is she here? I thought I saw her.
She's right back there.
Oh, with Sandy, we sold a house. And I mean, this family, they were like loved in the neighborhood. So when we posted that it sold, it was a lot of, oh my God, I'm so sad to see you guys go. Little Jamie and Bobby are gonna miss playing with your kids, things like that. It varies, yes.
So are you cross-posting stuff that I see
yes.
Into the group as well?
Well, it depends. If it's specific to Northlake, so for example, let's say I listed a house on Mariposa in my farm. I'll talk about Northlake within the Facebook group page in Northlake. when I post it on my private page, I might not like constantly talk about Northlake because most buyers don't really know where Northlake is. I'll say new listing in Cascade. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. All right, do we have any other questions?
Okay. Do you remove them like a month after they move out or anything like that?
You know what? We have not been removing people once they move out.
Okay.
A lot of the people that I've sold, they've moved out of state or I've sold them something else to Santa Cruz or Santa Ana Valley. They're still on the Facebook group page and they're liking things and things like that. There was somebody passed away that was well known in the neighborhood and it was posted on there, and it was actually kind of nice that all these older neighbors commented on it. So, yeah. Okay, events. So these are the events I do, the top two. I do a pie event and a summer event. The Thanksgiving pie event was extremely successful this year. So let me tell you a little story. Miss Sona. Did a Thanksgiving pie event. What I do is a month before Thanksgiving, I send out a flyer to everyone. I have the flyer up here, I think. I send out the flyer and I say, make your choice of apple or pumpkin, and they can email me, call me, Facebook message me, whatever it is. There was a homeowner in Northlake, her name is Natalia. I've door knocked her house, they never answer. I would leave flyers, never met her, but one day she called to request a pie. And she came, I finally met her, had a very brief conversation with her, super, super sweet lady. You know, I made a joke like, oh my God, you exist, I door knock your door and you never answer. And you know, she's a very sweet lady. Anyway, a couple weeks later, she sends me a Facebook message, a private message, asking me if I know anything about commercial real estate. And I said, of course I do. So then I called Sona, and I said, Sona, we need help. I need help. Can you help me with this? So her husband's dad needed to sell a commercial property in Los Angeles. And mind you, we weren't given a listing. It wasn't to come list me in any way, shape, or form. We probably met with them five different times. We were competing against other agents, but we got our foot in the door. Well, we ended up listing the property. We're in escrow right now, and the dad is giving the proceeds to Natalia and her husband. They're gonna buy two properties with their 1031 exchange. But it doesn't stop there, because the father's ex-wife, she wants to sell her house and buy to be closer to the family. So this is from one pie, from door knocking, from getting to know somebody and nurturing that relationship.
That's a sweet buy.
There's actually quite a few stories like that, not as many transactions, but again, you just got to go with the thought of, I'm just building relationships with people, it's not about real estate.
So this price event will cost you around $3,000, isn't it?
That much money?
Yeah.
No.
How much do you pay for?
No. I think the pies were like, I think it's $8 and $10. Apple was $8, pumpkin was $10, or vice versa.
Yeah.
And I think this past Thanksgiving, I think it was 70 pies.
Oh, not everyone.
It's not everybody. Okay. That's not everybody. It was 75. No, I buy it at Costco or Sam's Club. If you're going to do this pie event and you have a dog, buy extra. Because my dog is having 8 of the pies. 30 minutes before I had to hand out pies and I panicked. Yeah, it was awful. I had to run down to Ralph's. The difference between a Ralph's pie and a Sam's Club pie. Anyway, but this is a great event. And now I do it every year. And now I really have to do it every year because people expect it. When I went to family reunion, anyone here go to family reunion? There was a lady up there on stage that she did a little bit of a spin, and I'm gonna try it. Is she sent this out a month before and said, if you send us a referral between now and pie pickup day, we'll give you a free can of whipped cream. Anyway. I don't know what people will think about it.
But she got referrals.
People love free stuff.
Oh yeah?
They love free stuff.
And it doesn't have to be
a big deal. This is the summer event that I did. It's not the same picture because I was on a team at the time, so it's not the same branding. But what I did was, this was a little bit more expensive, but I had, at the time, some vendors helping me out. I don't ask me about the rules about that because I don't know. But we had a taco guy out there. We had Kona Ice. We did a food drive. That was a list of all the things. We had so many people, and it was so much fun. And it's about the kids. Make it about the kids. It's, you know, free fun for families. They're more than likely going to show up. It was awesome. I'm definitely going to do this again. Yes.
Do you think that this neighborhood is typical of all the neighborhoods? Do all these neighbors all bring their kids to a central place that don't know each other and mingle and everything? You've had good turnouts?
Well, it wasn't always like that. It grew into that. Our neighborhood grew into that. The HOA is really, every year they do a movie night at the pool. They do one of those blow-up screens. They have a movie night. They just did a big Easter egg hunt. Not everybody goes, but our
community, but every HOA hosts one.
Yeah.
They are doing quarterly events at minimum.
Yes. So they come to that, or there's the events that I do, and then there's other people within our Facebook group that have get-togethers. One year I did Bunko. Other people have done Bunko. They do little get-togethers for moms or whatever. So it just kind of takes off.
Did you hold this at
in front of my house.
Oh,
yep, I opened up my garage and the taco guy set up, and the bounce house was in front of my driveway. The Kona Ice guy just drove up.
And we've got tacos right now at like 3 hours for $300.
Yes.
The blow up was like a.
It wasn't bad at all. It wasn't bad at all. Mm-hmm. It was fun. I thought it was fun. Oh, awesome.
That was my question.
Oh, okay. Perfect. And then this was Bunko. I did all this, put together Bunko, and realized I hated Bunko. And I had to like stick it out. Oh, there's my address if y'all want to come visit me. Okay, this is my last slide. So it's really important to not take your foot off the gas. If you put in months and months and months of hard work, and you're consistently door knocking, and you're meeting people, if you stop, they are going to forget about you. You have to be consistent. All that work that you put in is going to go away. Somebody mentioned safety. I always tell somebody that I'm going door knocking. I always tell them where I'm going so they know. I always have my phone on me. I usually have people check in with me. I'll say, call me in an hour. Just check on me. If I don't pick up right away, it's because I'm in the middle of a conversation with someone, and I'll call you right back. But I always make somebody aware that I am not door knocking.
Teresa,
yes. Oh, it's a great question. So one of these things in the scripts, if you go down to the bottom where it says meeting homeowners.
What was the question?
Oh, she wanted to know if I ever go in their house when I door knock. One of the scripts at the bottom is asking them if they know how much their home is worth. When they start having a conversation with me, I always, 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 always ask, have you done any upgrades to your house? A proud homeowner usually loves talking about what they've done to their house. And sometimes they'll say, well, you know what, let me just show you. I did this backsplash tile, and I put in these new carpets. The best thing that could happen is you go into their house. You build rapport immediately, and it actually helps you, as you guys know, you're all realtors, to do a better CMA for them.
What if it's a guy?
If it's a guy, I go in the house?
Yes.
I do, only because I feel safe. If I go on a listing appointment and it's a guy, I tell everybody where I am. I am a trusting person, but I'm not stupid, so I try to be aware of what's going on.
Right, it's like a creepy situation.
Yeah. And the last thing I wanted to say is when you're establishing yourself in your farm, this is really important, this last bullet point. I am a crazy driver. I have road rage. I flip people off. And I run stop signs. I'm just, because I drive a lot, you know, when you get home, you just want to get home. And one of the times in my neighborhood, I flipped somebody off with the sign in my neighborhood. I learned that quickly.
But she was a jerk.
Then there are times when I go to the local grocery store, the Ralphs, and it's like I'm in sweats and a sweatshirt, and nobody knows if that's like what I sleep in at night, and I have no makeup on, and, you know, it's always those days that I run into people. So you need to be aware. If you're trying to establish yourself in your neighborhood, you need to go out looking presentable. Just the other day, I was pulling my trash cans out because I had forgotten on Thursday night, and I was in sweats and a t-shirt. My hair was no makeup, looked like crap, I was tired. And I go out there, trash cans out, and up comes a neighbor, and she says, "Oh my God, I've been wanting to talk to you. I'm relocating out of state. I want you to come by and take a look at my house." And I was like, "I'm so sorry. I look like..." I mean, I felt really bad, but I mean, she was so sweet and kind about it. But you just need to be aware of that. You know, don't get too comfortable in your farm. You kind of need to.
But if you had waited 5 minutes to do your makeup, you might have missed her.
Exactly. Yeah. Opportunity. Okay, so I have two. Actually, I lied. I have two more slides. This I got from my good friend Sean. Sean had this in his office. Sean used to be at this office. I love Sean's hair. This is great. Take a picture of this, and I'm also emailing it to you. It's all about follow up. No matter what, even if they say they don't need anything, it's about following up so they remember you. It's not about the sales. Remember that. It's about them getting to know you. If you see them once a year, they're not going to remember you. So this is really important. I have this hanging up in my office. A coach that I recently had told me about this. Why I like this is because the swimmer at the top, a lot of times that's me. I'm too caught up and worried about what other people are doing. Whereas Michael Phelps is only focused on the end result, the finish. So again, everything that I taught you guys today or talked to you about, not taught you, but talked about, take what you want, but just stay consistent and make it your own. Put your own stamp to it, put your own personality to it, because that's what I've done and it's been successful. Hey!